us today, James Turk. James, thank you for joining us.
Thanks. It's great to be with you.
Well, sir, I want to get into gold and some of your recent visits. I know you were in Asia a few weeks ago. But before we do, we've all seen people ring the bell on the New York Stock Exchange or the Toronto Exchange. And if you could just give us a little kind of behind the scenes, what goes into it, and what is the significance for your company?
Yeah, it was really fascinating being there and ringing the bell. It's not like the old days where you had brokers running around the floor. It's all electronic these days, but it did get the exchange open and getting it started. The process is actually a very difficult one, and it's one we've been working on for several months. We wanted to achieve this milestone because listing on the main board brings with it more governance, and that's key in terms of our business model. The more assurances of integrity that we can provide to gold money customers, the better it is from our perspective, to build up that level of trust. And the main board has additional disclosure requirements, additional governance requirements, et cetera, that you don't have on the venture exchange. The venture exchange is a good stepping stone, but now that we've achieved the level that we've achieved in terms of the company's business model and its presence, moving to the main board was a logical step. So it was an important milestone for us, and I'm very proud of that accomplishment.
Well, congratulations. For gold money, which people can either store gold or bid gold where they can use the MasterCard, I mean, this is really something, it's something that I think the gold market has wanted and desired for a long time. And now, man, it's just happening so fast since this merger. I hear people all the time, people that I didn't even know were interested in gold, and they're so proud when they talk about the two companies that you work with, or I guess one company now. Did you ever see it happening so fast the way it did?
No, I really didn't. When I first met Roy Sabag and Josh Crum, the two co-founders of BitGold, I was very impressed with both individuals, and when we did the deal, I had high expectations in terms of what could be accomplished. But even my high expectations have been exceeded. It's all happened very, very rapidly. And the interesting thing is, there's a lot more to come. We've been rolling out different products, rolling out different services, and I can't get into details, but there's a lot more coming down the road in terms of what we're going to be doing. And I'd just like to refer to one point you mentioned when you're talking to friends. One of the interesting things that we're seeing in the BitGold side of the business is that more than 50%, we don't have the exact number, but it could be as high as 70% of the people who are buying gold, they're buying it for the first time. These are people who've never been involved with gold before, but they're recognizing the utility, the usefulness of using gold, not only as a means of saving, but also as a way of making global cross-border payments, because it's very inexpensive compared to the alternatives. It's very convenient. It's 24/7. And most importantly, you're outside of the banking system, so you don't have counterparty risk. The way to envision it is there are two global networks. There's this big banking global network for payments, and there's this little tiny global network for gold payments that Gold Money is building. And we're providing a bridge between these two systems. And we believe that this gold network that Gold Money is building is going to continue to grow and develop in the months and the years ahead.
Now, when people hear BitGold, the first thing they think of is this some way associated with the digital currency Bitcoin or something like it? Could you just give us a description? Because I think my subscribers, without a doubt, are familiar with gold money, but yeah, Maybe not so much big gold.
No, the only connection to Bitcoin is the word bit. And BitGold itself is a online payment mechanism, which Gold Money used to operate up until 2012, but now BitGold is doing that. So you have the capacity, the capability of of within gold money and in BitGold, you know, to make these gold payments within this gold payment system that operates outside the banking system. I would like to add, though, even though we're outside the banking system, we're inside the regulatory system. So we follow the same governance procedures that all of the, you know, world financial institutions follow.
Where is the gold stored?
Well, you have a choice. There are several different countries where we use vaults. The vaults are owned and operated by professional storage companies like Brinks, Loomis, Malka Almut, G4S. These are all, you know, professional global storage companies, and we have locations in Canada, UK, Switzerland, Dubai, Singapore, Hong Kong. The individual who's buying the gold makes the choice, or gold or silver for that matter, because you can buy silver through gold money. They make the choice as to where they would like that precious metal stored for them. And the important thing is that you actually own that gold or that silver or that platinum or palladium for that matter, because those are available too. You actually own those metals. So in contrast to national currencies, you know, gold is money that you own. That's a big fundamental difference, because you're not reliant upon any bank or any counterparty. It's gold that's stored safely for you in the vault. And you know that it's stored there because of all of the various governance procedures we provide, you know, the regular audits, the insurance, you know, online 24/7 access to your account. You can take delivery of your metal if you want to do that. We work with Dillon Gage in Texas, so you can convert gold into physical coins if you want to take delivery of physical coins. So it's a full service capability for anybody who's interested in precious metals, and they should be interested in precious metals because of what's going on in the global financial system.
Well, let's talk about that. You just got back from Asia. You know, 10 years ago, there was a lot of talk about, you know, China or the East just making a big shift out of the U.S. dollar. You just were in Asia. What is the current view over there with money managers and even government officials? What is their current view of the U.S. dollar and U.S. monetary system that essentially is the king right now for the world?
Yeah, it's not. There's a lot of worry, but not just about the U.S. dollar or the U.S. banking system. You know, there's a lot of worry about the euro and the euro banking system. What's going on in Japan, etc. And also, there's even concern with what's happening in China, because, you know, it appears that there is a credit bubble there, and people are wondering whether or not the Chinese government will be able to manage their way through the slowing economic activity and the impact that that's having on the credit bubble in that country. So there's a lot of worry and a lot of concern. And, you know, in that kind of environment, people look for safe havens. And when you're talking about safe havens, you're talking about tangible forms of wealth rather than intangible forms of wealth. In other words, you're looking at farmland, timberland, oil wells, gold, silver, you know, tangible things, as opposed to intangible things like T-bonds, T-bills, you know, insurance policies, or anything with kind of counterparty risk or denominated in terms of a currency. And I think the real question is that's being asked not just in Asia but everywhere is, where are central banks leading us? You know, we're in uncharted territory. We're doing things at the central bank level that have never been done before in history, but it's stuff that just logically doesn't make sense. It's anti-capitalistic to have negative interest rates, for example. And, you know, where you're paying the Japanese government to take your money, it just doesn't make any sense, and it's not doing anything for the economy. We see that despite all of these policy measures that the central banks are pursuing, economic activity is, if not in a recession, you know, it looks like we're bordering a recession in many places around the world. So there's a big question mark, you know, do we want to follow central banks and the path they're taking, or do we want to take our own path? And when you start asking that question, you want to look at tangibles of all sorts, and particularly when you're talking about money, you're talking about gold. And I'm mentioning here, of course, physical gold, not paper gold or any of the paper alternatives, which have counterparty risk. I'm talking about physical gold.
James, what is going on behind the gold market right now? Because we're seeing a major breakout, and the whole thing's changed. I mean, we're making higher highs, higher lows. Silver's now breaking out. The mining shares are just absolutely exploding.
Yeah.
So what's going on behind the scenes with the physical market and precious metal sector in general?
Yeah, it's all unfolding as you expect new up cycles to unfold. We're seeing strength across the board in all the different sectors of the precious metals. But the question is, what's the underlying reason? What's happening? You know, over the past couple of years, I think people have been, they put the blinders on because they see that commodity prices have dropped, and therefore, when you're taking, lower energy prices, lower oil prices into the equation, it sort of gives you the impression that inflation is contained. But over the last couple of years, even though commodity prices have been falling, inflation in labor, inflation in services, that's continued to rise. Now, toward the end of last year, things started changing. Commodity prices started bottoming out. You know, gold was one of the first ones to start leading. But if you look at what's happened this year, agriculture commodities are up. A lot of the base metals are up. Gold and silver, doing very, very well. This is one of the best years ever in terms of the way the precious metals have started. So I think what the markets are telling us, they're giving us a clear message that commodity prices are going to start rising. And given the fact that we're already seeing inflation in services and labor and things of that nature, that there's going to be a lot of inflationary forces coming to play as we move toward the end of the year. And I think that's the big surprise that we're going to see as we move toward the end of the year, that inflation is going to be the shocker. People aren't prepared for it. And I think that's what commodity prices and metals are telling us. Money is moving out of IOUs, out of national currencies, into stable things like precious metals and like commodities of all sorts.
James, I saw that Stanley Druckenmiller, zero ounces of gold this time last year, then 20% of his portfolio, now 30%. The large German reinsurer made news a week or two ago where it's buying physical gold. You're all over this market. You see who's buying. And I mean, are you even surprised a little bit by, I mean, there are some really, really smart, big hedge fund managers, conventional institutions now entering this market?
Yeah. I am surprised, but I'm not surprised. In the case of Druckenmiller, I am surprised that I didn't think he'd buy gold, but I'm not surprised because he's one of the best money managers out there, over the past couple of decades. He's compounded his wealth at a phenomenal rate of return year in and year out, looking, in a global macro sense. So what he's basically saying is he believes gold is ready to move, and he's put a large part of his portfolio into gold. That's why he's been successful. He's willing to make these outsized bets, and they've worked very, very well for him throughout his career. And it's not just him. There are a lot of other money managers that have announced that they've been moving into gold as well. And when that happens, I think, we should be paying attention to what these smart guys are doing.
Last question, James. The mining sector. I know we talked about it years ago. However, of course, the mining shares got it worse than the physical metals. But at this point, with the precious metals up around 20%, but the big guys like Barrick and Newmont are they're a double already this year. Do you think that most investors, after having a core physical position, should consider mining shares, or is that not meet the qualification of a tangible asset? Even though I don't know if this is what you're going to say, but it's a claim on a tangible asset.
Yeah, it's what I call a near tangible, in the sense that it's got a claim to a tangible asset, but there are other aspects to it. When you're buying a mining company, you're buying the management team, you're buying that balance sheet, you're buying the political risk that comes with where that mine is located. So you're making an investment in a mining company, and that's different from gold. When you're buying gold, you're buying money. So what you need to do when you're buying gold is you compare how gold has done in preserving purchasing power compared to the national currencies. That's the liquidity or the money part of your portfolio. Mining shares go in the investment part of your portfolio, and you have to compare the potential of a mining share investment to any other investment that you might be thinking about at a given moment in time. So keep that distinction in mind. It's very, very important. When you buy a mining company, you're not buying gold. You're buying an investment in a company that mines gold. When you're buying gold, you're buying money. And you compare gold to other forms of money where you want to hold your liquidity. And looking as to what gold's done, not just over the past decade or two, but over the past 100 years since the Federal Reserve was created in 1913, it's been a downhill move for the purchasing power of the dollar, which is why the gold price rises decade after decade after decade.
James Turk, founder and director of Gold Money. You can check him out at goldmoney.com, bitgold.com. And if you'd like to reach out to him directly, he's at the Twitter handle FGMR. And we'll have all of his information as well on our YouTube channel, website, and iTunes post. James, thank you so much for joining us today. I really appreciate your time. And my goodness, congratulations with everything you've accomplished with your gold businesses. Certainly, it's something to be very proud of, and certainly revolutionary. And you've done a great thing for those of us who want to learn more about the free market, but also want to actually be able to act on sound money principles. And you've